343 just released a couple of anthologies. One is Evolutions that we're talking about, and the other is Halo Legends, some of you might have seen. I wanted to ask Frank, how do those stories, when you have a universe like Halo, how do you take the short stories from these different venues and sort of work, how do they work fit back in?
They connect in different ways. Some of them just connect to the universe broadly, and they just have, you know, meaning to people who are familiar with the events and the places and the objects in the Halo universe. But I think with Evolutions and Legends in particular, we wanted to make sure that everything had specific, useful connections to other places in the universe. So you'll see that there's definitely a couple of Easter eggs hidden in the books that have connections to future events, future fiction that we're working on.
Do you want to tell anybody what those are?
No, I want to find them. No spoilers. Spoiler-free Comicon. With both projects, actually, what we did was when we were thinking about who was going to be creating these, whether it was animators, writers, or directors, we tried to make things that were appropriate for that artist's skill set, and we always try to do that. We like interpreting in our universe. It's a very strong universe that Bungie created, and it stands up to it stands up to a lot of different types of interpretation, both artistic and fictional, and that's definitely thanks to the strength of the universe that was created in the first place. So we can do something like, say, as we did with Production IG, we know that people want to hear more about the elites, and we can go to Production IG because we know that their art style and their direction and their kind of dark, somber tone is a good fit for that kind of part of the universe. So we do this a lot. We did it with the Halo graphic novel with Marvel, we'll continue to do it in the future for things that make sense. And usually these pieces of fiction are asking or answering questions that people have asked. I want to know about this corner of the universe that I'm not familiar with, or I'm really curious about this. You won't be seeing Baird again, except in pieces. But as I said, everything that we do really for the last couple of years has a specific purpose, and there are seeds being planted in the universe that will pay off in the long term, to the point where we have some of this stuff mapped out for 6 or 7 years. We don't want to get in a situation where the stories are spiraling out of control or the universe is getting too large and scattered. So we have a really good strategy in place for where it all kind of ends up.
So I want to turn to Greg and both Eric at the same time, which is tricky for me because you're spread out. So
sorry.
Back up. Last year at the con, you guys, if you were here, you were here. We announced that Greg was going to be working with 343 on a new series of novels. Can you guys tell us anything about what's happened in the year that has passed?
We can't give specifics, unfortunately. I will say that every time we have a meeting, we come across a decision that's just jaw-dropping in terms of implications and further storylines and everything. And Frank will haul off and hit me if I talk about some of the stuff we've been doing.
I'll get out of the way.
But I've been known to be writing big science fiction in the past, and this is some of the biggest science fiction that I've ever written or read. The scale is going to be utterly astonishing, and at the same time, it's a personal adventure story. So I think it's going to be terrific fun. And right now, working with this group is just a privilege. These guys not only take my ideas and run with them, they add to them in a very creative way. And with my son working with me, and also having his own ideas, and you know, since he has access to my library and much of my imagination, it's pretty amazing when it all comes together. So that's what we're doing now. I'm not sure. I think I'll probably be delivering the first book in the summer. I have an early title for it, but I don't know if it's going to be approved or not. So
we're flexible, bendy.
Yeah. No, we've been
Shall I give the working title? Since
yeah, working titles are safe.
Okay. Working title is Antediluvian. And if you know anything about biblical history, you'll know what that means. So,
what brought you to Halo?
Tor did to start with, and then Frank, and you know, the suggestions echoed back and forth, and I'd been following this Eric's adventures through Halo over his shoulder, and sometimes trying to learn how to use the controllers. And
he's not very good at it.
No, he's going to take me through the whole game in about 3 hours, I think. But But watching all of that, I realized this is classic science fiction, you know, military science fiction to a great extent, but really is. And the underpinnings, when I see what these guys, the work these guys have put into the background of the universe, it takes me back to my teenage years when I was reading Heinlein and Doc Smith and all that stuff, Edmund Hamilton. I mean, it really is classic SF. And so that plus the fact that by going into the Forerunner area, we're actually entering Arthur C. Clarke territory, that's like old home ground for me. That's the stuff I love to do and work with.
Eric, you can tell how that conversation started.
It was magical. It was the simple question was, we should get someone like Greg Bear to write this. And then I said, why don't we get Greg Bear?
Yeah. So he came from a shopping list of one. It was, yeah.
And so, voila.
So, Frank, I kind of gathered that you'd just read City at the End of Time, and you thought that was a good intro to the whole experience.
Yeah, I mean, if you haven't read any Greg Bear, I suggest you go to a bookstore and pick it up. He does gigantic sci-fi at the scale that the Forerunner stuff hints at. And really what we're going to do is take some of the enigma and the mystery from the Forerunner universe and really explore it. And I don't think it's going to make it smaller. Yeah. If anything, it's going to get bigger and more awe-inspiring than it already is as an enigma. As a revelation, I think it's going to make people sit back and take notice. So looking forward to it. Specifically, we're definitely dealing with events before the flood and maybe leading up to the flood. And I don't think we can really say more than that.
Yeah.
I just wanted to mention to everyone who's here today, obviously we handle the extended franchise for the Halo universe, but really the meat of the Halo universe is and always has been the games. And right now that means Bungie. They're working very hard on Reach, as you know, and the public beta is coming up in the next couple of months. It's going to be a very big deal, I think a bigger deal than the Halo 3 public beta. And I encourage you all to go buy ODST so that you're locked in to entry to that beta. I would say we're not really going to talk about the game today, but I would point out that a lot of the Bungie artists do other kinds of art in their spare time. And the Bungie artists actually have a table out at the Artist's Alley, and you get to see the kind of stuff that they do. Some of it is sci-fi, some of it's not, but there's some amazing talented artists there. And they're out there signing stuff, and I think even selling some of their art. And it's always one of my favorite parts of Comic-Con is to go and see what those guys are cooking up in their spare time, because everyone knows that the stuff that they do during their day jobs is pretty spectacular. So I definitely encourage everyone to go check out Artist's Alley and maybe meet some of your favorite Halo artists if you can. I can't say much about Reach, but I can tell you that I'm fairly confident that it's going to be my favorite Halo experience ever for all kinds of reasons, from multiplayer to single player. And I'm really looking forward to playing against some of you guys in the beta.